देर इज अ टेक्स्ट कॉल्ड देवी महात्म्य, सो इट हैज थ्री सेक्शंस, मधु
ओके
कैटव वध, महिषासुर वध एंड शुंभ निशुंभ वध. सो वी डिस्कस द फर्स्ट टू पार्ट्स इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो. सो डू यू रिमेंबर व्हाट हैपेंस इन द फर्स्ट पार्ट, मधु कैटव वध?
No, you have to remind me. I'm sorry. These names are so hard to
So
remember.
there is a so in the Madhu Kaitabha Vada, what happens that Vishnu was sleeping and it is a summary. So Vishnu was sleeping and some demons pop out from the ear dirt of Vishnu. And since Vishnu was sleeping, he was just sleeping. So Brahma got afraid. I mean, they are going to attack him. So he started praising the sleep goddess, the Yoga Nidra. That is the sleep goddess or sleep. So to come out of Vishnu, so that Vishnu can awake and kill the demons. And hence the sleep goddess responds to her, to his prayer, and withdraws herself from Vishnu, and then Vishnu wakes up and kills the demons. So in this sense, and then Brahma could only create the universe. So basically the yoga maya, yoga nidra, that is the sleep goddess, acts as a prime mover. So I mean, she doesn't kill the demons directly, but she acts as the prime mover. So and the next part is the Mahishasura Vadha.
I don't know why this reminds me of Adventure Time with the time guy sleeping and having to dream the universe or something like that. I don't know. There's an episode in Adventure Time exactly like this. But go.
So some people interpret it as like, some people interpret it as like, so the world, I mean, makes sense to you only when you wake up. Your consciousness makes sense of the world. So this is the metaphorical interpretation. With if you are sleeping, you the world doesn't exist. It, I mean, when you only when you wake up, the world is created. And okay, so then the next part is the Mahishasura, the Gita. Yeah. So Devi Mahatmya is one of the same level as the Gita for most of the Bengali Hindus. Yeah, exactly. So it is recited in the worshipping places. Many of the times it is recited. So the Mahishasura Vadha is the second part of the story, where what happens that Mahishasura is an asura. He captures the land of the devas, the Swarga Loka, that is the heavens. And what happens, he just turns them away. And what happens is that they all gather together, and their fury, the fury of all of them, the enrage, everything comes together, and the bright light comes together, and this forms a goddess-like figure. And that goddess then finally fights with Mahishasura and kills him. So Mahishasura is a shape-shifting demon. He shifts to different animals time and again, and finally he is finally the goddess is able to kill him. So this is again an interesting thing. Like in this story, in the original story, there is no mention of any boon that Mahishasura gets. Mahishasura just captures the demons, the goddess kills Mahishasura. Okay, so this is a very plain story. But in the popular culture, when they show it in TVs or just like oral stories, when they say, they will add another thing with the story. That Mahishasura, by doing some penance and all, got a boon that no man can kill him and only a woman can kill him.
This
is
a
like
bone?
To justify that why and the boon,
a bone?
Boon. Do you know what is a boon means? Bead, O-O-N.
Huh?
You know, like blessings, boon.
Oh, okay. I had to look it up. Okay. Wait. How do you spell it again?
Boon is like a, like, so boon is like something you get, I mean, how can I say? I mean, you ask for something from the gods and the gods give you something that is a boon, okay?
Okay, all right.
So after doing some penance and all, he gets a boon so that he can't be killed by a man. So he should be killed by a woman only. And finally, the woman is created, okay? So this story actually justifies the, I mean, in some sense, it seems like the power of a woman. On the other hand, they're also justifying like why the gods can't kill him, like the gods are powerful, but why they can't kill him themselves, like why the goddess is required in the first place. So in a patriarchal society, that needs to be justified, and hence they are making up additional parts to justify that. Oh, why the,
this
and
is,
why the goddess is
this is like the
because
movie,
no man
like,
can kill him.
This is like the Wonder Woman movie where when they made Wonder Woman as a weapon against the evil, against the God of War, right?
Yeah.
She
so
was
such a,
created.
Such a theme is also there in Lord of the Rings. Yeah. Such a theme is also there in the Lord of the Rings, because there was a woman who killed a shadow monster kind of thing. Yeah. So we will talk about the third part.
Go on.
It's the opposite, of course. Yeah. So Shumbha Nishumbha is okay, so the third part is Shumbha Nishumbha Vadha. So again, the same thing happens. Shumbha Nishumbha are two brothers. They capture the land of the Devas. The Devas are turned out. they go to the Himalaya mountains and they start worshipping the goddess. As I have told in the earlier video, that the goddess who resides in the form of intelligence, sleep, hunger, etc., like abstract qualities among all human beings, that goddess, we worship that goddess to come to our rescue. So it is like an abstract goddess, okay, abstract concept. So now the Parvati is a, literally means woman of the mountains. So she is passing by, okay? So to bathe in the waters of the Ganga, and she asks, like, who are you worshipping? So, and at that time, from her body, a bright light comes out, okay, and separates out, and that takes the form of another goddess, that is the Kaushiki. So she is fair complexioned, and she is Kaushiki. And the original Parvati becomes dark complexioned, so she is the Kalika. So that is the black goddess, okay? So the Kalika goes to the mountains and stays there, okay? So she is the benevolent Kali, okay? So she is the smiling Kali or benevolent Kali that you see, okay, sometimes. So that I think the inspiration comes from there, the benevolent Kali. So she goes and sits on the top of the mountain, the dark Kalika. There is Parvati, basically. Now the Kaushiki that comes out, yeah. So Kaushiki goes and like she is just sitting at some place, and Chanda and Munda, these are two asuras who are like
asura. Asura means demons, right?
You can take it in that sense. It doesn't exactly mean demons, but you can take it in that sense. It is a rivalry of the devas. Okay, so these are two groups. So the Chanda and Munda are enamored to see Kaushiki's beauty. So they just go and see Kaushiki, and they are enamored, and they say that, and they go to Shumbha and Nishumbha and say that, oh, you Shumbha and Nishumbha, see, you possess everything, you possess the heavens and everything. So you should possess that lady also. She is also like a jewel, so you should possess her. Okay. So why is she still not possessed? And then Shumbha and Nishumbha send a messenger called Sugriva to Kaushiki, and he goes and asks her, like, okay, I mean Shumbha and Nishumbha are asking you to marry one of them. So she says that, okay, but I have a vow. I have already taken a vow that I will marry only the one who has defeated me in battle. So, I mean, they say, like, what are you talking about? Like, but they say that, oh, I know that, I mean, but what to do? I have taken already this vow. Tell them, tell your masters, like Shumbha Nishumbha, that I have already taken this vow. So Shumbha Nishumbha, after hearing this, get enraged. And then they sent a asura called Dhumra Lochana with all his armies and all to bring Kaushiki, the goddess, distressed and dragged by hair, like, I mean, if she doesn't agree to marry, then just drag her by hair and bring her. So, wait, and see the word again and again, they're saying the word like possessing her and all. So this is like very, like in modern rendition again, they will say that Shumbha and Nishumbha went and asked Parvati, like, will they marry her? And Parvati just got enraged and then fought with them and just killed them. This is the modern oral retelling of the story, or in the television shows also. Like, this is actually somehow wrong, because this is the crime of Shumbha and Nishumbha is not that they wanted to marry Parvati. This is not the crime for which they were killed. They will be killed at the end. So, and I mean, some people called you also Shumbha Nishumbha, like, oh, Shumbha Nishumbha also told that Kali is sexy, so they faced the wrath of the goddess. But the point here is that they wanted to possess her. They wanted to treat her like a slave or some kind. Like, they wanted to drag her by hair and possess her. And I mean, that is a different thing. Okay, so that is like marrying.
Is this scripture justifying rape? Can you say that?
No, it is not justifying. It is condemning. It is condemning the thing.
Wait, so I didn't understand. Sorry, who was
to do that?
Oh, okay. Oh, the asuras were trying to do that.
Asuras
sorry, I lost
to
the
do
plot.
That to do that to her, but she kills. She finally ends up killing them because they tried to do that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Good. Sorry, I lost the plot for a second. It was getting too many elements. We need a chart. You need to have like a chart, like visuals. So I have the asuras on one side, the devas on the other side. Because there's so many names, I keep like losing like who's who in the story. I was like, who are the good? So the bad guys were trying to so who the demons? This asuras are demons, and Parvati is the goddess, the good person.
For your convenience, I will say asuras as demons. Then okay. if you can't remember the name. but there are specific names of the asuras also, like Dhumra, Lochana, and all these.
Okay, good. Okay, good.
So then the
Why did they change the story? Then why did they change the story in the modern? This is a good story. The asuras were trying to rape a Hindu goddess, and she destroyed them. So why do they keep that story? That's like a positive message. I also assume this is bad because you said they changed it.
No. They changed it because they want to make it more sensitive. Like just asking some girl to marry, or just asking to, I mean, just getting sexually attracted to a woman itself becomes a crime. Like I'm saying, that the offense becomes a bit lesser.
All right.
Like not the attempt at dragging her by hair and possessing her, but just finding her sexually attractive becomes a crime. So that is
what. I finally get it. Because I thought that this must be justifying rape if they're changing the story and they're trying to not to be embarrassed.
What they're doing is that they're
making just a mere attraction to a goddess. They're trying to make that as an evil thing that deserves her killing them. Not just them trying to rape her, but just the fact that they even consider. Wait, what these modern renditions? Like, how recent are these changes? Because it must be very recent, because Hinduism...
In a popular culture, in TV channels and all, I think in the TV channel, another reason can be that they don't want to show the violence and all these things, like they, because the children are watching them and they don't want to show this, like all these violent dialogues, like drag her by hair and all these like violent things, like I want to possess her and all this. So that's why they tone down it a little bit, maybe. That may be another reason, I don't know. These are in popular culture, like TVs and all. Okay, so now she goes and Dhumra Lochana. So we were at... okay. So yes. Thank you, Kitty. Okay. So Shumbha Nishumbha... okay, so Dhumra Lochana...
Don't worry.
Dhumra Lochana is the name of the asura. Okay, so Dhumra Lochana is the asura that was sent initially. So he goes and says that, okay, I have to take you. I mean, will you come willingly, or we should take you dragging by here? So she says that, okay, I'm a lone woman. What can I do? Do whatever you want. So as he approaches, like the goddess makes a sound, like, oh, sound, something like that. And Dhumra Lochana gets reduced to dust with that sound. Mm-hmm. Okay. And the lion of the goddess, with the goddess, there is a lion, pet lion. So that goes and kills all the army of whatever the army was. Then next, Shumbha Nishumbha sent Chanda Munda, then said that, okay, so if she is not agreeing, first wound her and then drag her by hair and bring to us and bind her, then bring to us and wound her if it is necessary, if she's not agreeing. Then they go and try to do the same. Then from her forehead with the fury, the Kali comes, dark-skinned goddess comes out. So that is the furious Kali. So there was the one Kali who remained in the Himalaya mountains, that is the benevolent Kali, and another Kali comes in the battlefield out of the forehead, that is the furious Kali. So there are two different Kalis. So this Kali, what she does, so here are certain things she held in his hand. So sword, noose, skull-topped stuff, garland of skulls, tiger skin, gaping mouth, tongue lolling out, red eyes. These are the descriptions. So she is lolling out the tongue, and then like the, she's wearing a tiger skin, garland of skulls, and having all these kind of skull topped stuff and all these things. She's a terrible, I mean, she's very fierce.
So there's two Kellys? So
she's very fierce. Yeah. They're the same, but like there are two forms of the one Kali is the one who comes out in the battlefield, and another Kali is one who remains in the mountain after the bright-skinned goddess comes out of her. So as I told in the beginning of the story, so she remains in the mountain, Parvati Kali.